Yeah! That was the fastest I've ever seen that man move. I haven't even seen that move that fast in soccer. In the wheel game, there are all sorts of fitment, which means you've probably seen the meme where they talk about hella fail and hella flush and stance and dropped and slammed and mexi flush. I don't know, there's these all these different names, but when you really break it down, there are four major types of wheel fitment. We decided that we would talk to you about it today because we're kind of, that's kind of what we do, like as a business in our name, Fitment Industries, that's the plug. So before we get started, don't forget to subscribe. We're trying to get to 100,000 so we can keep making really cool videos like this, so please help us out by getting there. And of course, if you're looking for wheels, tires, suspension, head out to fitmentindustries.com. But before all of that, you guys will click past that part. Anyway, let's get into number one. So the first main style of fitment is tucked. Tucked fitment is when the wheel and the tire with suspension components as a whole sit within the stock fender. Now you can achieve that with aftermarket fenders as well, or over fenders when people do their math wrong. But really, tucked fender is kind of like a look, and it is a thing that's pretty well common. Tucked fitment is something that a lot of people do depending on the certain circumstances that they're building their car for, which kind of sounds a little bit weird when you think about it, but here's what I mean by that. A lot of individuals will do tucked fitment for two reasons. Either one, they messed up, or two, they're doing it for air suspension. Now, tucked fitment is something that is extremely common on air suspension vehicles that are looking for a tucked fitment. It usually makes the vehicle look wider, look bigger, and when it's on the ground, it does look really, really good. But tucked fitment usually results in a less wide track setup or a less wide stance setup because of them trying to fit the wheel inside the wheel well. In addition to that, you also have to remember that if you're going for a tucked setup, you're usually looking at a higher offset wheel because it's gonna bring the entire wheel inside the fender. So a lot of people that are running a tucked setup, especially on their air suspension cars or stock cars, are usually looking at a very flat profile wheel. You're gonna see that on a lot of different vehicles, especially at the 45 to 55 offset range. But tucked is extremely common, and you'll see it pretty much only in the air suspension scene. You won't see many people running a full tucked setup on coilovers, but you will see it sometimes when people make a mistake on their fitment. Don't do that. Use our gallery. Makes our life easier, makes your life easier. We don't have to take the email of you guys emailing us back saying that you have tucked fitment and you thought it was gonna be poked, or you thought it's whatever. We're just gonna get into the next one. Tucked fitment does require you to know a couple things. A lot of times with tucked fitment, you are going to have to roll your fenders. Now, if you didn't know, a lot of times with your fenders, you have the metal and it swoops inward, but it doesn't actually swoop upward, which is the way that you want it to, especially when you go into air suspension, which, you know, if you don't fix that problem, you're ultimately gonna cut into your tires. It also requires you to understand that you're probably gonna need to have a very narrow wheel as a whole and a very flat facing profile so that you can fit everything underneath just fine. But then of course you're gonna run into, well, potentially rubbing issues, especially with the suspension components. It's not something that is the most common type of fitment, but when it's done right, it looks extremely, extremely good. I think those style of tucked fitment look great on an air suspension vehicle that's like smaller, sport compact, something like an Audi TT looks absolutely killer with a tucked fitment in it. Now, a lot of people will argue that tucked fitment can be done with just the wheel, just the tire, or the wheel and tire together, but in our eyes, we see it as the entire wheel needs to be inside the fender liner. The second and probably one of the more common setups is the flush fitment. So if you guys think tucked fitment is when it's inside the fender, you can assume that flush fitment means that it's on par with the fender. Now, like I said before, a lot of people argue, what is a flush setup? You'll see people take pictures of their tucked fitment and call it flush, and it's just not how it works. People will say it's either the wheel or the tire, but really in reality, it's both. You wanna make sure that if you're doing a flush setup, that the wheel is matching up to the fender liner dang near perfect. Flush is going to give your car a meatier setup in terms of how it looks, mostly because you're gonna get that setup, that flush setup, with both wheels and tires. The tires help out so much with giving a flush, strong look when you're looking at it, and it's probably one of the most common setups when you're looking for like track-oriented or actual use purpose for your wheel fitment. A lot of people will run a meaty setup, and that usually requires their wheels to be flush with the car. Now, when you run a flush fitment, you do need to take a couple extra things into consideration, and it is something that we would probably say is a little bit tougher to achieve than your tucked fitment. And the reason that we say that is because it requires just a little bit more math. And don't get mad at us, but that's the truth. When you're looking at getting different wheel fitment, you're talking an aspect of millimeters. And if you're millimeters off, or if you buy the wrong aspect ratio for your tire, you can completely mess up the flush look and ultimately result in a tucked look. And if you're running static suspension on a wheel that has a tire that's pulled back, it's gonna look a little weird. It's gonna look like you're supposed to be on air suspension when you're not. Flush is probably one of my favorite looks and was something that we see the most common use of on most cars, but it's definitely something that's common for the actual like track. If you're looking to get something that's gonna get the job done the best way possible, you can upsize your tire size based on your wheel width, which I actually explained in another video on how to calculate tire stretch or, you know, meat. You can do that, check out the video. I think it's gonna be like up there. And last but not least, the flush fitment look is probably gonna give you the best bang for your buck. If you're looking at something that's maximizing the space that the wheel can be in with your tire, you're gonna result in something that's gonna make your car feel better. And there's gonna be very few times that you're gonna be able to upsize your tire to where you start to lose traction path, especially when you're looking at a flush fitment. It looks great, it's absolutely killer, and at the same time, it's probably gonna maximize the performance if that's something that you really care about. Now, not some people don't, and that's completely cool. We're gonna get into the third type of fitment, which is poke fitment. Now, if you guys didn't know, this is probably a running joke for a lot of people that when you make a mistake with your fitment, you probably have poke, and sometimes that's true. Sometimes people mess up their offset and they ultimately getting a wheel that sticks out half an inch instead of being inside their wheel well half an inch. But poke fitment actually has a little bit of a history and story behind it. You see, back in the day when you're at the drag strip, there were a lot of people like your dad or grandpa that would ultimately go to the track with their car, switch out the wheels in the back, and then run it down the strip the whole day. And what they realized is that there's very few regulations in regards to how big your rear wheels could be in relation to your fenders, especially if you're just running it for fun. As a result, people started running wider wheels in the back, and because of just the way that it ultimately worked, the wheels started to poke out more and more and more. Over more time, you had ultimately the domestic market starting to grow this fascination with having wider wheels in the back for both track purposes and function. And then eventually, you know, the car scene took over and they're like, that looks really cool. I'm gonna do that just because I have a Camaro and I wanna do that, or I have a Mustang and I wanna do that. And ultimately that's where a lot of the poke scene comes from. Now, that doesn't mean that it's not in other scenes, because everybody gets mad when we try to relate it to one specific community. But poke fitment does have its heyday predominantly in the muscle car scene, and for good reason, and that's what people like to do. But poke fitment's a little weird. You're also gonna see it on different types of vehicles as well. VW pickup trucks usually have a poke fitment when they're done right, and it looks pretty baller. There are other types of people that like the poke fitment style because it gives them the more aggressive look. I did it on my own Datsun one time and I thought it was really cool. Then I didn't the next season. So I had to sell my Diamond Racing Steelies for like $80 a pop. It was a good time. Poke fitment is something that's a little bit weird because it doesn't usually require as much math. Usually when you look at your offset, you just go smaller than the recommended offset, which is gonna poke your wheel up. But a lot of times you're gonna thrash up your fenders and it's gonna look a little bit weird if you don't do it correctly. Now, poke fitment does look pretty cool on some muscle cars if you're looking at the right setup. A little bit of poke never hurt anybody, as long as you have the suspension components that are actually going to keep your car from destroying your tires and destroying your fender. Because if you have a stock fitment or you have a stock suspension with some sort of poke fitment and your car is wobbling all over the place and you go to launch it because you want to race a car at a stoplight, you're probably going to tear into your tires and it's just no fun. Now, you're probably wondering where the fourth one is, and that is probably the most common one right now, and that's what we're going to call stance fitment. Now, there's probably people already in the comment section talking about how that's not the proper terminology and that it should be cam hella flush or hella fail or whatever it is. But ultimately, when you look at it from a bare bones balcony point of view, it all kind of surrounds the same style, and that is stance fitment. Now, stance fitment takes cues from pretty much the other three in terms of fitting different style wheels widths to achieve a different style look. But what stance has that the other ones don't is more of an aesthetic purpose rather than just a function purpose. And at the same time, it starts to play with a lot of things that the other three don't really need to. When you look at stance fitment, you could say that, you know, like a Dodge Hellcat has a stance to it, which is very true. But a G35 on 12.5 wide, you know, Concept 1 CF003s has stance, and that's the difference. Every car can have a stance, but not every car has stance, which is really weird when I start saying it out loud, but if you've watched the video between Juice and Sauce, you'll probably get it as well. When you look at the fitment, the stance fitment game, you're looking at things that include camber, toe, adjustment, drivability, you're looking at air suspension, you're looking at angles of different things to make sure that the wheels fit appropriately. We've talked about it in the past, but not every stance vehicle needs to have negative 12 degrees of camber. A lot of it is just very slight camber to fit whatever they need to do. But when a car has proper stance, that's when you're really looking at just a nicely done car. But it is one of the hardest types of fitment to get. You start playing around with things like stretch, like camber, like suspension components to make these wheels fit. Now, you can use like camber gang and all that sort of stuff to encompass the stance fitment. But overall, stance just has something about it that's really unlike a whole lot else. We always talk, well, not us, but there's a lot of people that always talk a lot of smack against stance fitment, yet they're always the same people that ultimately look at the car show on Sunday. is. So in terms of stance kind of being, you know, the odd one out, it still is probably one of the most popular ones that people really enjoy looking at. And it requires the most amount of work. Stance fitment really is something that's a little bit crazy. You're talking about different sort of degree angles and things like that you don't have to worry about much when you're looking at a tucked fitment or even a flush fitment. Poke fitment is usually just something if you have a domestic vehicle or if you made a mistake, which if that's the case, you might have to go into stance fitment or buy some over fenders like our boy Jasper did one time when he bought 4.5-inch lips. In terms of other fitment, there definitely are others out there, but those are the four most common types of fitment in terms of what you're probably going to see in the community to this day. So let us know in the comments what sort of fitment you have, and don't forget to subscribe. But if you're looking for wheels, tires, and suspension, head up to fitmentindustries.com and we'll help you out. If you're gonna be at SEMA in a couple weeks, by the time this is out, we're doing a meet and greet at the AccuAir booth 4 p.m. on Tuesday. You can meet me and see how bad my receding hairline is. I'm Alex from Fitment Industries. We'll see you later. Peace.